This is the traditional territory of the Miwok tribes in the Southern Sierra Miwok. This was their home. We came here 150 plus years ago. They've been here thousands of years. This was their pharmacy. This was their grocery store. Their livelihood was based on the forest. Forestry used to be a real industry in the Sierra Nevada, and it's appreciated to where it's not even really here today, and wanted to see that happen again. I think of nature as being, obviously, it's always producing a yield. I mean, that's what nature does. Nature grows. When we try to figure out what do we do to change this narrative, what we're talking about here of how to manage our forests and create a circular economy, that we're basically seeking to find, you know, no waste. Can forests be the engine room of the bioeconomy? In 1849, a million people came to California during the gold rush, first year. So all of a sudden, these forests changed in dynamic. They just saw the timber to basically to extract. But that extraction model didn't really have all the science and understanding that this is an ecosystem. Fast forward 100 years, and we have a totally different forest that's really ready to burn. These huge overgrown forests in California that have ladder fuels, tons and tons of extra biomass that are burning more intensely and more severely, which never happened when the Native Americans were here. Wildfires have done billions of dollars of damage, millions of acres in North America over the last decade. It's a crisis. The chapter of what we had in the past of forestry with clear cutting and taking large trees and not reforesting or deforesting, that chapter is closed. The new era of forestry globally is a one of balancing the ecosystem. My name is Tom Hobby. I'm a forest economist and an agrologist. We've been working through this last few years to help set up a bioenergy company here in California. Yosemite Clean Energy was a vision that I had a long time ago. I was frustrated. I was frustrated which I saw forestry declining. Our forests were getting overgrown. We can actually generate revenues which will help support maintaining these forests. Increasing the production of biofuels is a part of it. For example, in California, we have 50 million tons of biomass. We're using 3 to 5% of the wood waste in this state. For every ton of biomass that we actually take out of the forest, we can make about 1.7 barrels of oil equivalent. When you look globally of how much forests, you know, on our planet surround almost every nation and every continent, we have a lot of room to grow this into being a significant replacement for fossil fuels. We could replace 3 to 4 billion gallons of diesel per year, which is probably 60 to 70% of the diesel demand just from our wood waste in California. We're trying to go back to a historical kind of ecosystem which is in balance. And we're trying to balance that ecosystem by taking all this wood that's out here that's probably gonna burn if we just leave it here. We have a prescription and a plan. We don't rake the forest, we just thin the forest. We leave enough for biodiversity that every critter that walks, flies and crawls or swims is gonna have a home. We're trying to kind of mimic what the ecosystem looked like pre-settlement when the Native Americans were here. So all this wood here is a cost to the government. It's a threat for wildfire. Using our gasification technology, we can convert all this wood that you see right here that's just wasting away and costing money into a valuable asset. If you take a piece of wood and under high temperature, it turns it from a solid into a gaseous state. And that's the beauty. Once we get into that gaseous state, it's hydrogen, it's methane, it's carbon monoxide and CO2. And those are kind of the building blocks, which we call syngas, that really all these hydrocarbons that we're using from fossil can be replaced with a renewable resource. We can make biofuel, hydrogen, renewable natural gas, and aviation fuel from this wood. We have our business, we're building our first plant, but in forestry, one of the most limiting factors is transportation. It's really hard to get the fiber and the biomass from out in the forest down to a plant economically. So we can't scale up to have these million ton facilities because the transportation costs to reach those facilities is just too high. So we need a more moderate scale, maybe 200,000, 250,000 tons. How do we continue and scale up the bioeconomy? Really starts with what kind of processes and technologies can utilize this wood to the highest and best use. But that scaling decision is a really important thing. Ecosystems are dynamic, they're changing. There's no one plan that fits all forests. We have to take the biomass that's available, what's economical, and then work with the financial community to how do we get these investments financed and how do we get this work done? So that has to be really intentional, and it takes good science. We have to have good inventory. If everyone around the world could assess how much biomass that are available in their jurisdiction, the bioeconomy could replace fossil fuel with biofuel and be carbon negative, which would be a huge benefit for our carbon goals and our global climate change initiatives. I feel like we have an obligation to manage these forest wells for future generations. Yosemite was my playground, my backyard. I can remember the first time that I came and I witnessed this mammoth monolith, the largest living things on the earth. Some of the tribal people I've talked to in British Columbia said, you know, their philosophy was never to take more than you needed and always leave behind enough for the future generations. If you take care of the forest, it will take care of you.